In these hard times, let us look first to the response of love. In the midst of challenge, may our chalice flame bear witness to the inherent worth and dignity of every human. In the midst of uncertainty, may our chalice be a beacon of encouragement, that our values may guide our choices. Let us look first to the response of love. Maureen Killeran. Welcome all to our Sunday morning gathering of Summit Unitarian Universalist Fellowship. We are so glad you have chosen to join us today, whether you are here in the sanctuary or joining us virtually on Zoom. We have several announcements this morning. Melody, would you like to come forward first? Thank you.
Good morning. This is a shelter update, and it started last night with a full house and very exciting. There were 11 guests, a lot of volunteers, so thank you. Six children are part of our shelter network this year, which made it very lively. I told Pam this morning, a lot of happy noise. And it made it a lot of fun. And we had just some of the best food, the most wonderful volunteers, and even Joanne helped the kids with rock painting, which was very brave of her last night. So we just really are enjoying this already and looking forward to the next 2 weeks. Just a couple reminders. Well, first of all, we had few leftovers, so the amount that we're asking for is perfect. We don't want to have food waste, just the perfect amount so far. And we will update you if we lose some guests and ask for less food. But right now, as advertised, we need exactly what you are bringing. So thank you for that. Let's see, we did make a change to the times because based on some of the needs of our guests, they are arriving a little bit later at times. So we did send emails out about that. But just a reminder, we ask that food now be brought between 5:30 and 5:45. But even if you want to bring it up till around 6 o'clock, that's even okay. We're still keeping our dinner hour from 6 to 7, but some of them are having a harder time, I know, during the week with school pickups and different things like that. And we're asking for our helpers for the dinner hour to come between 5:30 and 7. So let's see. Those bringing food are not required to stay. However, you are very welcome to. And it was really nice seeing all the people last night interacting with guests and back and forth, and it made it very cozy. So thank you to those who have volunteered or signed up already. We have approximately 80% filled. Most of it is this week. Yes, I know. And it's amazing to me for such a small congregation to have this much involvement, and we just appreciate it so much. The second week is where we need most of our volunteers, primarily next Saturday and Sunday. So we'll be in the salon again, signing people up, and we'll have our board there that you can look at, and you can also find the link in the e-news, the Scene at Summit. We have some flyers around here at the church also with a QR code where you can sign up. And then last thing, just Social Justice in Action meeting today at noon in the library. So that's right, Aaron? Okay. All right, so thank you so much for all of your involvement already, and I look forward to the next 2 weeks. Thank you.
Thank you, Melody. Such a great job you and the team, Social Justice team, Interfaith Shelter team are doing. Al, did you have an announcement? While Al is making his way up here, I'll say briefly that restrooms for those of us in Sanctuary are available in the office, the library, and the salon.
Wow, I'm just kind of blown away from how well the shelter went last night. The mix with everything, the guests and what my announcement is about next Saturday morning. There will be a workshop here for the adults, and there is half a dozen children. They seemed to be very well behaved last night, maybe thanks to Joanne. But, there's ages 12 to 7, and what we need is child care. There's someone who feels so moved to come forward and help out with the child care over in the RE area, and it would be much appreciated. Maybe someone can find that, other than that, I think we'll all enjoy the shelter because so many of us are involved. It's really, really a nice bunch of people this year. Thank you.
Thank you, Al. I'll make an announcement immediately following the service today at 11:45 or so in the conference room, the conference room of the office space. There will be a short meeting of the Sunday service committee, and we are looking for more volunteers. We're asking for lots of volunteers these days, the shelter, pledge drive, et cetera, but for those of you who are interested in being in front of folks, if you will, for those of you with an interest in drama or being on stage, whatever, you know what I mean. We're looking for help. People who can help plan our services, people who can recruit speakers for our services, people who can be up here and guide our services, being a service associate. In particular, we need help soon because this summer our minister will be on her vacation, and there will be lots of opportunities to replace her. If that is even possible.
Be careful. Worship committee is how I ended up as a minister, so.
Yeah. So that's at 11:45 right after the service, before the Social Justice and Action Committee. See, are there wonderful opportunities to contribute in every way? Nancy, please.
Rin, you stole my announcement.
Oh. I'm
but
sorry.
But you said it better than I could.
I'm sorry, Nancy.
That's perfectly fine. We'll have somebody in the conference room right after the service in case you can't stay for the whole thing. It will be very short, and we have some handouts, so come and pick up a handout. And we really want to hear your ideas and suggestions, no matter how small or wacky or far-fetched. We're willing to listen, so thank you, and we hope to see you there.
I'm sorry? Oh, I'm sorry, Sandy.
Hi, we have an update on the pledge drive. Amazingly, we are nearly halfway there after 1 week effort. 23 pledge units have pledged. You know, we're soliciting from over 100, so we hope we can burst that thermometer. The average pledge is over $5,000 per pledge unit right now. So Pam, you want to tell them what they need to do to add to the total?
Yeah. The first half is the easy half. The second half is more difficult. So don't let down and keep going. And then we can stop talking too and get your pledges in any way you can. Like Sandy said, you know, just call it in, whatever. Get your pledge in so we can end this drive this month. We seriously want to stop talking and go on.
Thank you, Sandy and Pam. We stand upon land that carries the footsteps of many generations of Kumeyaay people, which stretches from the shores of the Pacific Ocean south to Ensenada, east to the sand dunes of the Colorado River and Imperial Valley, and north to Warner Springs Valley. We acknowledge that this fellowship resides on unceded Kumeyaay land in honor of the spirit and continuing presence of the Kumeyaay Nation. I'd also just like to acknowledge that 2 days ago, Friday, was Women's International Women's Day, and I'd like to just acknowledge all the wonderful women in our congregation who bring such light and love and courage and strength to our community. So thank you all. Child sliding. Oh, I'm sorry, Jen. Where's Jen? Testimony?
Good morning, everybody.
Hi.
Some people come to these things really prepared, and I'm not. But I want to just share a little bit about what this community means to our family and what RE means to our family. I'm trying not to get super emotional because it's really important. I think I've shared this story before about kind of our journey to Summit and how we really didn't think it existed. So we had been to First Church a handful of times. Our oldest went to preschool at First, the cooperative preschool there. And when we moved to the La Mesa area, we were looking for a community that was a little bit closer, and we had Googled a UU church, and it popped up in Summit, and we thought, that's not really a UU church. Like, it can't. And we had a really busy month of weekend plans, and we just happened to have this free weekend, and at the time we had our two oldest kids, and my wife Lauren and I said, let's just go check it out. We don't have the kids. If it's like totally crazy, we won't. We can just sneak out the back door. And we came, and it was this amazing place. And we were so excited to bring our kids back. We actually canceled our next weekend's plans. We brought our two older kids. We brought them to RE. We met Mary and all of this community here. And since then, we've added four more children. So our RE program is very full. It's also really interesting to talk about kind of circles of connection. So when we first came, one of the other families that was most active at the time were Andy and Tyler and their kiddo Simon. And so Simon's family actually brought two other families that are super active in RE right now. And it's a funny story that Ed has shared about kind of the language of what this community is. And it's called a fellowship, but they thought for the longest time it was this gaming, like Lord of the Rings. And they were like, oh yeah, you just go play every Sunday. And so here's these two other families that have been linked in, and you know, once they're here, they've really become a very important part of this community, the Martinez's and Elizabeth's family. And then for us, we wrangled in the Browns, who had been active in their previous city and were looking for a UU community here in San Diego. And so RE is becoming this place where families can bring their kids and they get stuck here in good ways. This community is a place for our kids. Sorry. It's a place where they can grow and have the support and the community here so that we don't have to do it all, because we do a lot. But Mary does so much. And the volunteers here and just having this space for them, it's more than I can put into words. And then to just top it off, I can get a cup of coffee. So thank you for being here for us and for our kids. And please bring in your pledge drives so that we can continue offering this to other families. And yes, thank you.
I think the first week I was here, I told Jen that I'm not looking to have children. That's not something that's ever been on my to-do list, but I was so excited that I get to help love her children and that it's my joy to get to help raise the next generation of UUs. And we can do that because our families love being here. So I am gonna ask for another volunteer commitment. One of the best ways to show that we're supportive of our RE is to volunteer with RE. I know you all want to be in here to hear me talk. I don't know why. But we record it, and it gets put up online, so you can go back and watch it later. The best way to make sure that our congregations can sustain themselves is through committing to your pledge and supporting our families. My home congregation, every single time the RE program almost disappeared, the church almost closed. RE is critical to the health and life of our congregations. So thank you for your testimonial, Jen. And our chalice lighting words today are words from Eric A. Heller Wagner. Blessed is the fire that burns deep in the soul. It is the flame of the human spirit touched into being by the mystery of life. It is the fire of reason, the fire of compassion, the fire of community, the fire of justice, the fire of faith. It is the fire of love burning deep in the human heart, the divine glow in every life. And please rise in mind, body, or spirit to join us for our UU hymn. And our reading this morning, hi, good morning. It's weird talking earlier than I usually plan on. Good morning, everyone. My name is Pastor Casey Marie Pandell. It is my joy and my honor to get to worship with you today. Whether it is your first visit or your 5,000th visit, you are whole, you are holy, you are loved, and you are so welcome here. Our reading this morning is entitled The Turning by Kiana Danae Perkins. At the last turning, I was invited to a meeting among the sun, the earth, and the moon. The sun asked, "Do you have space in your heart for a great light?" The earth said, "I will hold you down if you are willing." The moon said, "I will guide you if you need it." And it was easy to say yes to the energies of balance. So for a turning, we have found ourselves dancing. The sun took the lead, sharing a drop of their luminescence, held deep in my heart when the darkness loomed, held it on the tip of fingers when others called for it, coming to understand space, becoming a beacon, learning the nuance of shadow and light. The earth kept her word. I was planted deep and rooted hard. I was uprooted, replanted, and loved until I was healed and able to feel the small tug from soil calling me down, demanding I grow again. And the moon, a sister auntie, stayed faithful at my side, always hovering, always playing, laughing, reminding me that joy makes many forms and keeps no schedule, reassuring me with loving pats and, "Oh, child," whispered commentary, a subtle and wanted companion on this journey. And the turning is coming again. The sun said, "Daughter, you have done well." The earth said, "Healer, who is still healing, you always have a home." The moon said, beloved shadow worker, we will cast new spells soon. We radiate light, we rotate the life, we revolve back into love. Please rise in mind, body, or spirit and join us in singing hymn 18 in the gray hymnal. If you don't have one, they might be under your chairs. What wondrous love. Our joys and concerns are a time of community gathering, holding, and healing. Joys and concerns can be emailed or texted to me throughout the week, or can be handwritten near the chancel on a Sunday morning. Whether we share a joy or concern or not, all are welcome to light a candle. I have a few today. We will start with the first one from Pat Summers, who shares a concern, saying her sister Clara was recently hospitalized with congestive heart failure. Pat is asking that we keep her in our thoughts and our prayers. Pat, we hold your sister in our hearts as we hold you as well. Thank you. And I specifically put music before this so I would remember to go check for these. Jamie and Joanne share that they visited Carol and Wendell Rollins this past week, and it was a joy to see them and to get to see together. Carol is doing better, and Wendell is hanging in there. And remember that you can continue to send cards to them at their White Cliffs address. Michelle shared... It's really weird to hear yourself. Michelle shares that Miles is now home recovering from his triple bypass surgery that he had last week. They wanted to express their deepest thanks not only for the cards, but for the meals that you all have been helping provide. It has been a tremendous help as Michelle and the kids kind of go back and forth with who's helping Miles, and they wanted to express that they are so very appreciative for this community. And finally, Mary shares a joy and a sorrow. She is deep in the planning process for her husband Paul's memorial, which is scheduled for March 23rd at 1 p.m. here at Summit with a Zoom option. All are welcome, and Mary, we hold you in our hearts as you go on this journey.
We know that not all joys and concerns have been shared aloud today. Whether spoken or unspoken, we hold you in our hearts. And now I would like to invite Mary up for our time for all ages.
Gabe asked for a little wave, so I could see his face. Good morning. Thank you for that announcement. If I get a little beklempt, you'll understand why. So we are sharing our classrooms with our unhoused guests right now. So after the service, when we leave after my story today, all of our children and volunteers are going to go out. We're going to make a worm hotel in the garden. So if you want to, if you don't know what that is, you want to come find out, stop by. We'll be over under the canopy and over by the garden. But I wanted to show you something we always do in RE to start our classes, is we have this gift box. Also, it used to be known as a wonder box, but for this year, it's a gift box. Because we have been working on learning the gifts of what I call the Article II flower, which you will all be learning more today about. And this month, our theme is transformation. And so I have something in the gift box. Now, when we're in RE, we shake it, and we try to figure out what's inside. So you're not going to guess it this time unless you read the title of the story.
Worms.
There's no worms in here.
God, I hope you're not shaking.
I would not be shaking my red wigglers. Did anybody read the title of this story?
Dates for Ramadan.
It's got dates in here for Ramadan. So these are the dates. I don't know if anybody's ever had a date, but we're going to eat these over in RE to help energize us for making a worm garden. But dates are a special food during the Ramadan season. In fact, when I went to buy these this morning, there was a whole empty section because a lot of them had been purchased. So for those of you who may, our theme this month is transformation. And today is the first day of Ramadan. So Ramadan is a holiday in the Muslim faith where a month of fasting is observed. So has anybody ever, do we know what fasting is? What is fasting? It's not eating, right? Do they not eat for a whole month? No, that's not what happens. It's that we're not eating during when the sun comes from the sun up to sundown. So we can break our fast as a family after it's dark, and the first thing that is eaten traditionally is a date. That's the first food that is eaten. Now, when I was a child going to high school, my best friend's father was Egyptian, and their family practiced the Muslim faith in their household. So for a month of the year, she wouldn't eat lunch. And it was weird to me. I was like, why? Why are you not eating lunch? That's, like, different. And of course, I was curious, and I learned about what her family did. And the idea of the not eating for a whole day, what do you think that would make you feel like? Well, you'd be hungry. Yeah. What else might you feel? Maybe dizzy. What was the last one? Kind of lonely. Yeah, especially if you were at school. Like, my friend was the only one in our entire school who practiced that faith. So nobody else knew what was going on, but as her friend, we'd sit together, and so it would feel lonely to her. But we have a lot of families in East County who practice this faith, so I don't think it would be uncommon in school to have a friend who wasn't eating. And why do you think spiritually this would be a practice? Cleansing. Might it help you think a little bit about what it might like to have an empty belly? To not have that food after sunset? Might it help build compassion and understanding and deeper ways of loving each other? Yeah. So that's a transformative experience, isn't it? So if you ever experience fasting or choose to for a day or whatever, just do it with health in mind. But also understand that that's a transformation that you're putting yourself through, that you're experiencing. And have a date. Not a date, a date. So today we're going to go transform our garden space, and I hope you'll come out and visit afterwards, because we'll be out there digging in the dirt, and I'm really happy with so many kids here who had to get up super early to get here, so thank you for that. So that is my story for you today, and let's do our song, and we're going to head out that door to the garden. So.
Remiss when I introduced myself today that I had said that we were going to start a new practice last week. Does anyone remember what I said we were going to start doing while we were up here in the pulpit? Describing ourselves, and I have forgotten today. So belatedly, just so we get into the practice of doing it, I am a 34-year-old white woman with short, not quite pink anymore, very faded hair, wearing a mauve dress with a floral print and lots of tattoos and jewelry. So, I know we told you it'd be a little clunky, we'll get used to it, so. But I appreciate everyone going with me and making sure that we're making our services as accessible as possible. Please rise in mind, body, or spirit as able to sing. This is not one that you will have music to. This is from our Justice Choir songbook. This is number 38, We Walk in Love.
We'll play it through once first.
Okay. I'm trying to expand our music. Giving that a good go, folks. Please join me in a time of silent prayer, meditation, or reflection as I read words from Becky Brooks entitled Power Prayer. Spirit of life, I have witnessed a loud love, an out loud love that challenges me. I did not recognize it at first, the rumble of an ocean I had long been under. But here it is right now, and it looks just like the whole world could be. It doesn't play nice. Why should it when nice has only ever played it a lullaby? This love demands. A love so loud it lays rocks at the feet of children who can't find their path home. Spirit of life, come and bring in everyone across the pipeline any other way. This love is indifferent to tolerance. It invites you into your own heart where God loves self has come to take tea with you. Drink and know that like that other love, this love always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Perseveres. This out loud love makes no secret of its aim to get you free. But first, set fires. Throw the poison to the ground, match the love sound for sound, for we are giving birth to something new. Amen. I wonder how many of you in the room today had heard of Article 2 before Mary and I began mentioning it. If you have, go ahead and raise your hand. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Not bad. It's not about being correct or incorrect, but in like one sentence, can any of you tell me about it? Okay. Yes, and I had a note here about there being a lot of variance in knowledge, but none of you know what it is. Well, that's okay.
It's our shared values.
But it's more than that. Article 2 is just a section of the bylaws. But I like where you're going with that. You're on the right track. We're kind of at an impasse with Article 2 right now. It's something that has been in progress for literally years. And today's sermon isn't about changing anyone's mind or changing anything about the process. My goal today is to help you understand enough of the heart of the proposed changes that our potential delegates can make an informed decision in June when we, the member congregations of the Unitarian Universalist Association, vote whether to accept or decline the revision. What revision, you might be asking? Also, it's to help the rest of us become a little more knowledgeable and a little more comfortable with what all this stuff means. Now, were Summit's situation typical, you would have had a settled minister years ago who started talking about this process with you in 2020. That person would have spent much of the last few years having discussions and classes and meetings and sermons and all that good stuff that you use like. You might have been more in the know about your specific place in the process, and you might have been really excited or really dismayed about the entire thing. So if you're feeling a little surprised today and wondering what the heck are we even talking about, that's okay. The UU is big. We have over 1,000 congregations worldwide, and it's been kind of a weird time for all of us. So a little bit of background. When I was at my internship site last year, my sort of thesis project before graduation turned out to be a 3-session class with a few of the local congregations in Orange County who also were a little behind in the process. And this was to help kind of bring them up to speed, to explain where we had been and tell them where we still had to go. Kiana Danae Perkins is one of the people that the UUA had helped create this small group ministry that I used. It was a series that was created for that express purpose, and I tinkered and tailored with it to make it a little more easy to digest for a 3-session series, because it's supposed to be 6. Right out of the gate, 2 things became abundantly clear. People did not understand anything about what was going on. And for a non-doctrinal faith, which means that we have no sacred texts that lead us, man, oh man, are we really attached to words? I remember someone scoffing one morning and saying, "We've never done this before." And I smiled and said, "Sure we have. We do it every 15 years, but last time I wasn't a UU." And there was some grumpy muttering and a grumble from the back of the room where someone said, well, I don't remember ever doing this. And God bless my supervisor, Reverend Dr. Kent, is a no-nonsense kind of guy who piped up and said, well, you probably don't remember because it didn't pass last time. And did you engage with the process to begin with? The process being a part of our larger governance. Every 15 years, the UUA takes a good, hard look at its bylaws, evaluating if they reflect who we want to be as a faith. While some faiths have what's called a permanent statement of belief, we have Article 2, which is able to be changed as we, as a living tradition, are also able to be changed. It takes a lot of people engaging in a lot of the ways that you use love the most to make this work happen. And even then, at the end of it, it's not even a guarantee that anything is gonna change. The last change to our bylaws was 1987. For the record, I was born in 1989. The most recent proposed revisions up until now failed around 2010. Now, failure isn't a good or bad thing. It's just the end of a very long process. There are meetings and conversations and votes and revisions and more conversations and more votes and. Again, this is a years-long process. This time around, the study commission was charged in 2020 to begin their work, and it will culminate this June at General Assembly in what I personally hope is an adoption of the most recently proposed revision. The UUA shared, over the course of its work, the commission engaged in 45 feedback sessions with 4,611 total participants. Their videos reached 7,765 viewers, and their 29 surveys garnered a total of 10,925 responses. That is a lot of the democratic process at work, am I right? It's a lot of folks from our congregations joining in on shaping the future of our faith. Now, for my own part, I remember getting emails early on in the process, you know, in the middle of a pandemic and also as a full-time grad student working part-time. And I remember thinking, I don't have time for that. Delete. You guys, I didn't understand what I was missing out on. But you can bet 15 years from now, I won't miss my shot again. A very, very short elevator pitch of what the proposed article is right here on our wall. JetPig. Justice, equity, transformation, pluralism, interdependence, and generosity with our flaming chalice of love right in the center. If someone were to ask you what Unitarian Universalists hold most important in their faith, you could smile and say, JetPig. But like maybe explain it a little more than that. But these seven words, these are the core values of which many Unitarians think we are. And I want to agree. The UU that I love and that I want to help grow into the future champions of all of these things. These are the central ideas of the longer proposed revision, which those of you in person should have a copy of. I did that on purpose. The place where people keep getting caught up in this process, though, and I can hear some of you saying it now, what about our seven principles? Because they don't look like they're in that paper, do they? We know what our seven principles look like, and that's not it. The seven P's define who we are, right? What happens to them, and how can we be UUs without them? three things. First, we are, again, a living tradition, a covenantal, not creedal or doctrinal faith. We are UUs together because we commit to being so together. And if we allow ourselves to be, we are malleable, able to grow our faith into more loving, just, equitable, and mature places when we choose to work together for it. The seven principles are not a requirement of our faith, but a way of living our tradition out loud. Second, truly, honestly, not one person from the UUA has said if we adopt this revision that we have to stop using the seven principles. I love telling people that we have seven principles that express our faith. Eight in this community, because Summit has already adopted that one. But without looking and without using the kids' version, can any of you tell me what the words of the third principle are? How about the sixth principle? I get it. We love these words. They have helped define us for a very long time, but even I, as a minister, sometimes struggle to remember word for word our principles. The rewrite, however, has a long and short version of it, and not only a statement about who we are right now, but imagines who we can be into the future. Take a good look at those pages. Our principles are actually in there. Eleanor, do you have the page? Can you read pluralism for me nice and loud in your biggest teacher's voice?
We celebrate that we are all sacred beings, diverse in culture, experience, and theology. We covenant to learn from one another in our free and responsible search for truth and meaning. We embrace our differences and commonalities with love, curiosity, and respect.
Is one of our seven principles in there?
It's
number four, right? The responsible search for truth and meaning. Thank you so much, Eleanor, for being my guinea pig. Each of those distinguishing words has lovingly and poetically had our beloved principles woven into their meaning, into the very fabrics of the larger tapestry of our bylaws. Because all I gave you was a small section of a larger piece, because no one wants to read too much legal language in bylaws. In them, there is a sacred promise. The word covenant shows up in this document 9 times in what amounts to about 2.5 pages. We promise to work at all of these things just as we always have promised, in an effort to create that more just, equitable, and loving world for all. Love being at the center of that flower is no mistake. It is not a happy accident. We so love this world and everyone in it because we are inherently worthy and deserve dignity. Love guides us in all we do, on the easy days and especially on the difficult ones. When we're frustrated with another, when we fall short and we hurt each other, it is with love that we return to our covenant together, reaffirming our care for each other, this community, and the world. Now, as I've mentioned, we've mostly reached the end of this process. There are no more rewrites, no more amendments, no more Zoom discussion groups. The final bell tolls at the end of June during our online-only General Assembly, where our delegates from across the country will vote. It will take a 2/3 majority for these words to become etched into the history of our faith, and there is no guarantee it will succeed. If it does, the amendment will be adopted, and this will help define the future of our faith. Not fully define it, help define it. Should it fail, it is not a failure of the process. We are a democratic faith, and we have the right to vote as we see fit. But should the process fail, or should the rewrite fail, another question of the bylaws will have to wait at least another 2 years before it can even be considered again. And then the process will begin all over. So take those words with you. If you don't have a copy and you want one, let me know. Don't just glance over them, but I'm asking you to live with them. Sleep with them, eat with them, invite these words into your hearts. Should we adopt them, they will have already become familiar, like an old friend. And if we don't adopt them, there is still something to be gained by knowing them. As for our future delegates, who I'm pretty sure haven't been chosen, but you're probably in this room today or on Zoom, please do not take my word as law. As all of you know, I'm a big fan of not being a divine ear to God. Part of what I love about this faith is our ability to choose. So let's talk. Come speak with me. Speak with each other. We can schedule the opportunity to delve into this potential future. Heck, do you want 3 2-hour classes talking about it? Because I can do that too. I still have the document I used a year ago. You've got it. We'll get it on the books. I will happily run these conversations into our history and our theology and what this means for all of you if you want it. We can explore all of those deepest imaginings together, and then we can go out to eat and discuss it some more. The point is, this is our faith. There are not many faiths in this world who get to choose what happens next, who get to make the decisions in where we go together. We make this faith what we hope to see. So let's explore what that can be together. So may it be, and amen. Amen.
Thank you, Casey. Your Sunday morning offering is a gift that provides Summit UU Fellowship the financial resources to help build a better world together. The smallest gift is welcome. For those of you on Zoom, the link can be found in the chat box. Please select the Sunday plate option to allocate your donation to the appropriate amount.
I'm going to play a piece called The Prayer. It actually has words, it's a song, and it's a prayer for peace and wisdom. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen. Please rise as you were willing and able to sing 131, Love Will Guide Us.
In the gray hymnal.
In the gray hymnal, words by Sally Rogers.
Sorry to take such a lovely song and follow it up by something robust.
We're starting now only because I would love to see Summit get to engage with this part of our process the way that you deserve to. You were in a really weird time when it started. I wish this could be a bigger part of our community, but please take me seriously when I say sit with these words and live with them, because even if it does not pass in June, this is still a lot about who we are. Over 10,000 responses. This still defines who you use across the world see us as. Please sit with them and find where you see yourselves and the places we want to go together. Amen, shalom, salam, namaste, ashe, and blessed be. Go now in peace. May the light within you be a blessing to the world.
We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. Thank you all for being here today. After our closing circle song, we will have a 5-minute break. Then please be seated if you wish to participate in our community gathering. After our community gathering, you're all invited to go to the salon for refreshments and fellowship, or to the community or the conference room to talk about, to join the Sunday Service Committee.
Please come join the Sunday Service Committee if you need to work with me. And a lot of really, really wonderful worshipers.